my name is Caitlyn Trevor. I'm a teaching fellow in the Department of Music here at University of Birmingham. And I'm here to talk about horror film music today. I'm so thrilled to be here. Thank you so much, Matthias, for inviting me. I'm a huge fan of all the work coming out of your lab, and it's just been so great to be part of this workshop. So thank you so much. I've really enjoyed all the talks today, and I hope we can continue having fun now with some talking about horror film music here. So let's get started. So music successfully conveys many, many emotions. It's the reason, one of the biggest reasons why we enjoy music so much. It's why we use music in so many different contexts and parts of our life. And one of the main emotions that music generates is fear. And in the field of music cognition, which is where I am working, one of our biggest questions is how does music successfully convey these emotions? And I am really especially interested in how does music successfully convey fear? Anyone who's seen a horror film or played a scary video game or been in a haunted house has understood how great music is at conveying fear. And Neil really described this very well earlier today in his talk. Music is excellent at conveying fear, to the point where sometimes scenes in horror films, if you take away the music, they actually lose a lot of their bite. There actually used to be a great compilation on YouTube of jump scares without their music. It's gone now, so I can't show it, I'm afraid. But the jump scares just became kind of comical. I remember one of them was the hand coming out of the grave at the end of Carrie. And without the music, I mean, it's still a bit startling, but it's not nearly as scary as when the music really comes in out of nowhere and gets that good startle reflex happening. So I wanted to start with some examples of scary music just to get us in the mindset of what I'm talking about here. They are from four different films. I think it would be fun to have some guessing since this is a really great audience for that game. But they're really challenging. These are not themes. They are, you know, kind of just taken out of scores. So we'll see if anyone gets it. If anyone gets it, I'll be really impressed. But in any case, we're going to listen to them. So here's the first one. Any guesses? Maybe on the chat? I don't see on the chat, so I'll just tell you, this is actually the second one. Sorry, my animations got a little off. This is from The Babadook. By Jed Kurtzel. Here's the first one here. Any guesses? Not seeing any. This is from Crimson Peak by Fernando Velasquez. Now the third one, I'll sit that up here. And then the final one here. By Marco Beltrami. So we have a fun selection here. There we go. Okay. All right. So how does music express fear? A lot of research has been done on this topic, and these are some of the general kind of ways that people have realized music expresses fear. So they often use these kind of sonic, soft sonic textures. large timing variations of things coming in at different times unpredictably, large articulation variation, so kind of the attack of a sound varies quite a lot, wide-ranging pitch, so a lot of high, a lot of low, soft articulations as well as varied articulations, large tempo variation, we have a lot of speeding up, slowing down, sudden changes in tempo, ascending pitch, so general pitch trajectory rising, you have jerky, unpredictable rhythms, large sound level variation, lots of changing in levels of sound very quickly, dissonance, so kind of harsh sound, fast tempo, narrow, fast vibrato, which is that kind of waving of pitch, so very narrow, very quick, and sharp articulations. But a lot of this research has been missing a really crucial consideration, and that's emotion granularity. Emotion granularity, it's the ability to recognize in yourself and in others finer grain emotional states that may be similar to each other. And it's also the ability to communicate those distinctive emotions. So not just to recognize, but also to tell someone how you're feeling. We can look at this emotion wheel to talk about this. This is quite old, but it's still a nice depiction of what I'm talking about here. So consider, look at the umbrella of mad. You have maybe rage versus hurt. Those are really different emotional experiences, but they kind of can fall under the umbrella of anger. And so basically, scary film music research wasn't looking at different types of fear, it was just fear in general. And what I noticed when I was researching scary film music is there really seemed to be different types of fear being communicated here, not just one type. And I think you could hear that in the music we listened to earlier. So let's listen to the first one here again. Compare that to now this one. So these are quite different. They're different in many different ways across the music, very marked acoustic and musical differences. Yet they're both described as music that conveys fear in previous research. What I was hearing when I was listening to scary film music is that there's at least two subtypes of fear being conveyed here, and at least two because there could be even more if you really dig in there. But there's definitely at least terror, and there's anxiety. And so the first one I heard was more this anxiety suspense type of music. The second one was more what we would call terror. And when you look at psychological research on fear, these two types of fear can be differentiated functionally. Terror is a reaction to an immediate fear, whereas anxiety is a fear about a potential danger that's maybe going to come in the future. So those are really different functions. The terror one is meant to be a reaction that is self-preserving in a moment of real fear in reaction to a danger, whereas anxiety is more about planning and preparing. So these are different behaviors. And also in research on neuroscience, these two types of fear have been found to have kind of different networks in the brain. So they're really separate types of fear that we're looking at here. And music seems to be communicating that as well. So I wanted to study this, and in my study, I had two different aims. The first one was to create a really large database of ecologically valid, and what I mean by ecologically valid is music you hear in the world, you know, not like manufactured for a study, but real music. Ecologically valid musical excerpts that communicate terror and anxiety respectively, and I was gonna call it fear muse. Mm-hmm. And I also wanted to use that database to then uncover the sonic differences between music that convey terror and anxiety with these two types of analyses, descriptive and acoustic, which I'll go through during this talk. So the design, I really modeled after another paper that was on music and emotion by Erola and Duskowski from 2011. This is the paper, in case you're curious. It's a very good one. And basically what they did to create a database similar to the one I wanted to create was they took film music excerpts. So film music is really ecologically valid because this is music written in the real world for films that people listen to every day. So it's really real stuff. And they curated different kind of music that conveyed different emotions. So happy music, sad music, with experts. So people who have a lot of musical training. But then they validated those excerpts by using not emotion ratings by non-musical participants. So participants who didn't have musical training, so that they can see that these excerpts, musicians really think they convey these emotions, and also people who are not musically trained also think they convey those emotions. And this is the kind of design that I decided to follow as well. So I curated 90 excerpts that portray anxiety and 90 that portray terror. Basically, I looked at 30 different horror film soundtracks. I listened to them end to end many, many times, which was pretty trying on the nerves. And I took 3 excerpts from each that I thought really conveyed these emotions well, terror and anxiety. I used the plot of the film to drive selection, so I was looking for moments where there was an attack for the terror excerpts, and I was looking for moments where there was some kind of suspense to find those anxiety sounding tracks. And each one was 10 to 30 seconds in length, depending on the natural phrasing. So I didn't kind of just cut all of them the same length, because music has different ways of feeling complete or incomplete and expressing ideas in time. So it made more sense to let the music organically determine how long each section was. These are the films that I curated from, if you're curious. Very contemporary films. I wanted music that's today to really understand how music's communicating to a contemporary audience. I tried to make it as international as possible, but honestly, the vast majority are American films. But we have a few international out there, like Raw, that's an international one. Tigers Are Not Afraid. Midsummer is in collaboration with Sweden. So yeah, we have a few in there that are not just American, but good selection there. Then once I curated all those excerpts, I had participants listen to just a third of the curated excerpts alongside 30 excerpts that portrayed happiness and 30 that portrayed tenderness. Because listening to like an hour of just anxious and terrifying music is kind of cruel. So we mixed in some happy ones, you know, to keep things sane, keep participants sane. They only listened to a third because it was so much music that the experiment would have been extremely long if I had them listen to everything. So we just cut it down. Basically, the participants listened to a piece of music, then they rated on 7 scales the emotion that music conveyed. So they had terror, anxiety, happiness, tenderness, familiarity, and then also valence and arousal. If you're unfamiliar with those are dimensional emotion ratings. So valence is kind of negative to positive emotion, whereas arousal is like low energy to high energy. And you can kind of map all the emotions around that. There's this thing called the circumplex model of emotion, and that's what they do. So for example, fury would be extremely low valence, very negative, and very high arousal, so really high energy, just to give you an idea of how those scales work. We had 99 participants in the end, 66 female, 18 to 49 years old, and they were all non-musicians, so we had a strict criteria of who could participate, depending on how much musical training they've had. And they all had good English language skills because it was conducted in English, because I speak English, but it was conducted in Switzerland. So we had a lot of German-speaking people in Zurich, but everyone had great English and took it. So this is the kind of screen that they saw. They would listen to the music, and then they'd see how well does this excerpt portray terror, and they would click along the scale what they thought the answer was, and then something like this for valence. So it was very negative, very positive. So then we got all those ratings, and then the way I had to filter the database down, because I had 180 excerpts, and I knew not all of them were perfect at communicating these emotions. I wanted the best ones, so I wanted to narrow it down to only 100. And the way I narrowed that down was with this typicality index, and I took this from the methodology of the earlier paper I mentioned. So the typicality, I calculated it was the mean target emotion rating minus the standard deviation of its target emotion rating, so how much that varied, and then minus the mean of all the non-target emotion ratings. So for example, I had the typicality for terror, which would have been the mean terror rating, so which is the average rating, minus the variation of that average rating minus the mean of all the other emotions. So if something sounded really happy, it would be knocked out by the typicality index. It needed to be terrifying. So I found the typicality index for everything and then filtered them down using that index to the 50 most typical excerpts in each category. And then the result is this 100 excerpt database of music, 50 terror, 50 anxiety. And it's available for use for anyone who wants to use it. This is the Open Science Framework. You can just download it, as I've circled in red. So if anyone wants to just check it out, or if you want to study these types of music with participants in a psychological context, you can use this database. And the link for the database is in the paper, which I'll show at the end where the paper is. So now that I have the database, the next thing to do was to figure out how music is communicating these two emotions differently. And I decided to use two different analyses for that. First one was sort of more exploratory. It's a descriptive analysis. And then the second one was more confirmatory, and it was an acoustic analysis. So the descriptive one, I had a table with 13 different categories. These categories included general features, tempo, tonality, harmony, melody, bass, figuration, rhythm, texture, dynamics, instrumentation, sound references, and timbre. So many, many different aspects of music. Timbre, I wanted to discuss really quickly in case you're unfamiliar with the term. It refers to the quality of a sound. You can think of a cello and a horn playing exactly the same pitch, but they have a different sound quality. That's how you can tell it's a cello and a horn, even though they're playing the same music. That difference in quality is timbre. So it's a pretty large umbrella term for a lot of stuff happening in sound. So I made a playlist of the excerpts in Apple Music, and on shuffle mode, we listened to 10, we being my collaborators, we listened to 10 random excerpts per descriptor, and we're writing down what we heard happening in each of these categories. And the result was a really, really large table of many things. This is just a tiny piece of it. I'm going to show you a summary instead of just throwing the whole table up here on the board. But this is so you can see what was happening. We had the features, we had anxious music, and then we had terrifying music, and we were writing down what was happening in the database. So let's look at these results, and I'm going to go back and forth between talking about them and playing the music so we can really listen to these differences. So anxious music, in terms of tempo, you have these slow, heavy, ponderous tempi happening, tempi being the plural of tempo. Terrifying music, you have fast tempi, and also you often just don't have tempo at all, it's just a sustained wall of noise. So let's listen to one of these to hear the slow tempo. It's quite slow. I mean, the events, you're kind of waiting for them to unfold. Whereas for the Quiet Place excerpt, you have the very fast tempo happening. And also from it, you have this sort of wall of sound, kind of chaotic. No tempo really, just noise. Music. Anxious music, you have this sort of vast, spacious harmonies happening. If you look two more bullet points down, that ties into the texture as well. You have these really open, hollow textures. You have the music leaning on the extremes of pitch, so you have very high pitch and very low pitch happening at the same time, and sort of this absence in the middle. Whereas terrifying music, you have these very dense harmonies, you have these active, massive textures that go with that kind of wall of sound thing. So let's listen again. This one has a really nice, you can really hear the kind of high happening with the piano and then these low bass tones. So you hear the wide texture happening. High piano. And the low bass change there. That's that hollowness. Whereas again, with it, you just have the whole pitch spectrum is active. Oops, that's Quiet Place. There's also in anxious music, you have these sort of stuttering, sighing melodic figurations. You could hear that in the anxious one I just played. The piano is kind of doing this, just really stuttering, brief kind of melodic moments. Whereas terrifying, you have these shrill, fast step-like lines. You often have kind of violins just, you know, doing a tremolo. And in anxious music, you have quieter dynamics. You can hear that in the one I just played. It's much more reduced. Whereas terrifying music, you have screaming intensity. It's like as loud as possible, fortissimo. In terms of timbre, remember it's that sound quality. Anxious music is usually muted, distant, kind of dark. Terrifying music is really harsh, noisy, jarring. Neil mentioned my other paper where I looked at if it was mimicking the harshness of a human scream and found that, yeah, terrifying music really does kind of mimic that really harsh sound. If you can think of a scream and how it uses your vocal cords, it just pushes them over the edge, and that's how you get that kind of harsh sound. So terrifying music really, really utilizes that. Let's listen one more time to these examples and really think about the sound qualities happening. Let's do number two again. That has a lot of this kind of muted thing going on. And by muted, I mean it's sort of the sound of a clarinet mouth. It's this sort of dimming of the upper frequencies, whereas the terrifying music does not dim anything at all. And the brass in that is also very harsh, just kind of falling brass tones. And finally, there's these sounds that are referenced by each type of music. So what I mean by that is that the music is mimicking these sounds to get an emotional response. So in suspenseful music, you're hearing sort of ticking clocks, creaking doors, it sounds like whispers, these sounds that kind of make your hair stand on end but are not immediately threatening, they're just kind of suggestive. Whereas in terrifying music, you're hearing screams, you're hearing thunder, explosions, alarms, earthquakes, things that are an immediate danger. That's a big difference between the two as well. So, they do share a lot of things. They're typically in a minor key, although I hesitate to say that because really they're just extremely chromatic. It's hard to say what key it's in. Unpredictable dynamics, so both of them have moments where suddenly it's really loud, suddenly it's really quiet. Someone mentioned today that, or Neil, I think it was you, because you were talking about sound, that sometimes silence can be very scary. There's a great moment in Hereditary, which I'm sure many of you viewing have seen, where she crawls in the background and there's no sound at all, and it is so scary. So sometimes the silence is really, really good as well, in both terrifying and anxious kind of music. And I would still say that's music because that's the composer choosing to not put music there, which is still part of kind of the musical creation of the film. Also, they both use these pulsing bass lines, which we heard a lot. I mean, playing in a quiet place, that's a great example. A scared heartbeat. And some, they also both use these sustained bass lines. There's this nice use of sound just continuing, and you don't know when it's going to end, and that is really good at suspense, and also used really well in terror with the walls of sound. So both suspenseful and terrifying use these kind of sustained bass lines. And hugely unpredictable rhythms is a big part of keeping an audience jumpy, just not letting music ever be predictable, just having random silences, tempo changing very quickly, sudden entrances. Those are in both anxious music and terrifying music as well. So after all the descriptive work, I did some acoustic analyses to kind of confirm what I was hearing in the descriptive analyses. Acoustic analyses, essentially, you're measuring different aspects of sound, and it's quantifiable rather than descriptive, so it's a little bit more objective, which is nice. I looked at 13 different acoustic features that covered different aspects of timbre, dynamics, tonality, and tempo. And here are the results. So, what we have here, terrifying music is musically denser than anxious music, which is something we covered in the descriptive, so the terrifying wall of sound versus the open hollow textures. That actually also came out in acoustic analyses. Anxious music has a greater degree of loudness variability than terrifying music, and that actually doesn't surprise me, because if you think of terrifying music, it's pretty much full blast volume. Sometimes there's sudden silences, but it's usually quite loud. Anxious music, you have more of those kind of sudden moments to keep you a little bit jumpy, so you can see that playing out in the data. Both are highly chromatic, which is, if you look at mode, but very unclear. Yeah, they're highly chromatic. That's if you're looking at mode, which is in the bottom left here, the closer it is to the middle, the less kind of obvious the mode is. So they're both really chromatic there. And while terrifying music has a slightly louder, higher average loudness than anxious music, that was not statistically significant, I think it might be partly because of loudness variability, but also maybe the hypothesis was just wrong. The sudden silences in terrifying music might have been part of that. Also, tempo. Terrifying music has a slightly higher average tempo than anxious music, but that was not statistically significant as well. And I think part of that is the wall of sound excerpts brought that average down, I think, but that's just my hypothesis. These are all timbral elements. So we have brightness, roughness, spectral centroid, which is essentially, if a sound is brighter, it's going to have a higher spectral centroid. If it's a kind of darker sound, it's going to have a lower spectral centroid. And that's the case for a lot of these spectral ones, the spectral flatness, roll-off spread. I won't go into the details of what they all exactly measure, but higher means like brighter, rougher, and lower means darker, more muted. And then ZCR, again, zero crossing rate, is about noisiness. So higher it is, noisier it is, or rougher. So we expected what you see here, which is that for pretty much all of them, terror was going to be higher than anxiety, because terror is the brighter, rougher textures, and pretty much all of these measure aspects of that. And anxious music is lower because it's more muted and dark. And you do see that in the tables, which that was nice to see confirmed. So in conclusion, yeah, there is indeed a strong sonic difference between at least two subtypes of musically conveyed fear. There very well could be more, but these are the two really big ones. And in music cognition research, it's really important that these are distinguished between, because as I put earlier, you know, I put up all these different aspects of scary of music and fear, but these are kind of overgeneralized, right? Because they were taken from music that conveyed terror and anxiety at the same time. And these actually are quite different ways of working, as I showed earlier. So they need to be separated so that you don't make the wrong conclusion about how music is communicating emotions. If you're interested in more details on this paper, it's published in JASA earlier this year. And in this paper, you can find a link to the Open Science Framework if you want to download the database. I wanted to thank my lab back in Zurich, which was where I conducted this research, and also acknowledge the funding that made this research possible. And those are my references, and thank you so much.